Hi, everybody. Welcome to the University of Winnipeg. In the heart of downtown Winnipeg, Manitoba, we're located on Treaty 1 in the traditional territories of the Cree, Dakota, Dene, Ojibwe, and Oji-Cree First Nations, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. Welcome to this special talk by our special out-of-town guest, Professor Michel Chossudovsky, on the sensitive and timely topic of North Korea and the danger of nuclear war. Professor Chossudovsky is visiting us for the first time in more than a decade before going on to give a similar talk in Vancouver tomorrow and then on to Asia. Today is Martin Luther King Day, and while after nearly 50 years, we typically think of King in the struggle for racial injustice, we often forget that his dream was more comprehensive than that. Vincent Harding, who is a biographer of King's and wrote one of his most compelling speeches, Beyond Vietnam, he came to Winnipeg in 2009 and reminded us on this very stage that our society needed to conquer not the evil of racial injustice, but also of materialism and extreme militarism. And that third triplet will provide much of the focus for tonight's talk. Tomorrow, we're going to be seeing 17 nations coming together in Vancouver and focusing their conversation on how to pressure North Korea into compliance. A conversation that includes countries who sent troops to North Korea, but excludes Russia, China, and notably North Korean voices. Our speaker has an opinion on that summit and on how there are realistic prospects for peace. Professor Chossudovsky is an award-winning author, a professor of economics emeritus at the University of Ottawa, and a founder and director of the Center for Research on Globalization based in Montreal, and he's also the editor of the website globalresearch.ca. He's taught as a visiting professor in Western Europe, Southeast Asia, the Pacific, and Latin America. He's undertaken field research in Latin America, China, Southeast Asia, and Sub-Saharan Africa, and has written extensively on the economics of developing countries with a focus on poverty and social inequality. He served as an economic advisor to governments of developing countries and has acted as a consultant for several national and international organizations, including the Canadian International Development Agency, CEDA, the UNDP, the UN Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, the African Development Bank, the United Nations Population Fund, the ILO, and the WHO. He's also taught as a visiting scholar at the UN African Institute for Economic and Social Planning, Dakar. And he's the author of 11 books, including his most recent, Towards a World War III Scenario, The Dangers of Nuclear War in 2011, and most recently, The Globalization of War, America's Long War Against Humanity. And that there are copies of that book in the lobby, and which are for sale at $15 each, and he's, Professor Chossudovsky, I presume, is prepared to sign those if you should care to approach him. And I'll also mention that he has also won multiple awards. He's a recipient of the Human Rights Prize for the Society for Civil Rights and Human Dignity in Berlin in 2002. He received the Project Censored Award from State University of Sonoma, California, 8 awards between 2000 and 2015. Professor of the Year from the University of Ottawa, Faculty of Social Sciences, 2001. And he's also the recipient of the first national prize for the best research site website at the international level from 2008. That's from the Mexican Press Club Award, both to Professor Chossudovsky and Global Research. And in 2016, he received the Doctor Honoris Causa in Humanities, National Autonomous University of Nicaragua, Managua. Now, Professor Chossudovsky is going to come up in just a few moments, but first we wanted to show you a brief video clip which will help set the stage for tonight's conversation. So we'll start, I guess we'll play that right now.
Thank you. death also reached behind the front. The United States Air Force destroyed every town and city in North Korea.
We traveled in moonlight, so my impression was that I am traveling on the moon, because there was only devastation, and in a very funny way, every city was a collection of chimneys. I don't know why houses collapsed and chimneys did not, but I saw thousands of chimneys, and that was all.
When I filmed the destruction of the city by the B-29 aircraft, I had to tie myself and my camera onto a large pillar, since otherwise I would have been blown away. If a large bomb, such as a one-ton bomb, exploded, the blast was so strong it would demolish everything within 150 feet, just like paper.
...600,000 tons of bombs fell on the north. Probably 2 million civilians perished.
As I was filming, the child begged me to save his mother's life. He didn't realize she was already dead. I went on filming him through my tears. I had my job to do as a cameraman. I didn't stop even to wipe away his blood or strap up the wound on his back. I still feel a dreadful pain today whenever I remember that scene.
To survive the hail of bombs, North Korea moved much of its economy underground, digging deep into the hills. A subterranean world was created, with factories, dormitories, hospitals, and shops. Down in the tunnels, people could feel safe and lead a semblance of normal life. As in the South, Koreans never neglected education. Inevitably, though, it was the war effort and munitions output which took highest priority. With many men at the front, women took over all aspects of production and waged their own battle against the enemy.
We had a slogan: the rear is the front. Let's make bullets of revenge to give to the Americans. So we tried to produce more bullets and mortar shells quickly to send to the front night and day. We even took our meals beside the machines to continue production.
The bombing failed to have its intended effect. The fire that fell from the sky cauterized North Korean society. There was pride in standing up to the greatest power on earth, and people rallied round their government and their leader, Kim Il-sung, who was presented as the object of almost religious adoration.
No.
The price of this resistance was appallingly high. Kim Il-sung, speaking in his bunker on the anniversary of liberation, seemed heedless of the cost.
It was a long speech, much ovation, applauded. And after the speech, there was a party. there was singing and drinking and dancing. During all this time, we heard the bombs falling on Pyongyang. But it was not very convenient to show that we hear it. I mean, we had to behave as nothing would happen. And the whole party lasted up to 5 or 6 in the morning. Then, with the daylight, we went upstairs. And on the streets, I saw hundreds and hundreds of people killed during that night by bombs.
Good evening. I'm very much indebted to the organizers of this event and the opportunity to be in Manitoba tonight, Winnipeg. I think that the history of war crimes, extensive war crimes without precedent in world history, is the starting point of debate on North Korea and the dangers of nuclear war. According to official figures of Allied forces, including statements of General Curtis LeMay, North Korea lost up to 30% of its population during the 3-year bombing period. And I quote, after destroying North Korea's 78 cities and thousands of her villages and killing countless numbers of her civilians, General Curtis LeMay remarked, quote, I can't imitate his accent, unfortunately, over a period of 3 years or so, we killed off, what, 20% of the population. Curtis LeMay was one of the major generals who led the bombing campaign. And these casualties are unprecedented in the history of warfare in terms of percentage of population. If you look at World War II, well, some countries like Russia, Yugoslavia, Germany may have lost up to 10%, but we're talking about 30% of their population in consistent bombing raids. And the irony is that this country, this remote country in Northeast Asia, is labeled as a threat to global security and to the security of the American homeland. Now, I think we have to put this in perspective. With all due respects to Donald Trump, fire and fury started well before his mandate as President of the United States. This was a rhetorical statement at the United Nations General Assembly. It was an ugly statement, but if you look back in history to World War II and the wake of World War II, you have an unprecedented sequence of fire and fury in Korea, in Vietnam, in Indonesia, in the various war theaters of the Middle East. And you also have, and that's, you also have a decision-making process within the military and the executive of the United States, which covets, and that started even at an earlier stage, the use of nuclear weapons against civilians. Well, inevitably, nuclear weapons are against civilians. I've chosen to address these two issues, two related issues, the history of North Korea and the history of nuclear war. And there's a certain, sometimes I will divert and then sometimes come back, but bearing in mind, we have a major concern regarding North Korea and the dangers that this may in fact lead to a nuclear war, and which would escalate into a third world war. I think that is one of our concerns. And the other concern is to understand the logic of the nuclear weapons right from its inception in 1939 under the Manhattan Project. Now, the Manhattan Project so happened to be a project not of one country, but of three countries, including Canada. It was United States, Canada, and Britain. And the United States started the Manhattan Project prior to its engagement in World War II. And it had a mandate. I will discuss that a little bit later on. But I think we should also understand, and that maybe is the main purpose of my presentation, that we are at a very dangerous crossroads in our history. Mistakes and miscalculations are often the major cause of historical change. And we might compare, and some authors have made these comparisons, our present situation to the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962. Now, we're not dealing with the same geopolitical context, but what we can say about the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962, where Soviet missiles had been stationed in Cuba, was that both the US head of state, John F. Kennedy, JFK, on the one hand, and NSK Nikolai Sergeyevich Khrushchev, were acutely aware of the dangers of nuclear annihilation. They were engaged in the Cold War under the so-called doctrine of mutually assured destruction. It was the notion of deterrence, that the Soviet Union needed nuclear weapons to counter US attacks and vice versa. But what distinguishes the Cuban Missile Crisis, which was considered to be extremely dangerous, to today's realities, is that those diplomatic channels have virtually been closed down. There is no dialogue between Russia and America at the diplomatic level. We're familiar with the Russia Gate saga. There's very little in terms of a dialogue with North Korea, and certainly the United States has done everything to block that dialogue, and things have evolved in the last couple of weeks, because on the one hand the South Koreans and the North Koreans are now talking, and those meetings were determined at a much earlier period, but these are not trivial meetings. They're large delegations, and they're meeting. And they're meeting on a, they're having a bilateral discussion. Now, our government with our distinguished foreign secretary or foreign minister. I'm not quite clear what the label is. It's changed so many times. External affairs, yes. She and Secretary of State Tillerson have taken this initiative. In fact, it was Tillerson. It was the State Department that took the initiative, and they hooked up with Canada, and they're not involved in any kind of diplomatic undertaking. Because if it's a diplomatic undertaking, you would at least invite the three member states who signed the Armistice Agreement of 1953. Now, the Armistice Agreement of 1953 means that the countries are still at war. A peace treaty was never signed, and the United States persistently blocked any kind of initiative to sign a peace agreement. Now the North and the South are meeting, and my hunch, and I'll discuss it again at a later stage of this presentation, is that a meaningful peace process would have to bypass the United States and in effect contribute to nullifying the armistice, so that it wouldn't be a peace treaty with the United States, because they refused to negotiate, but it would be a peace treaty between North Korea and South Korea. And that is the kind of process which, in fact, is ongoing now. But when I compare the Cuban Missile Crisis to the current crisis, the diplomatic channels are blocked, at least with Russia. They're certainly strained with a number of other countries. But at the same time, the leadership in the United States of America doesn't really, I'm referring to the President of the United States, doesn't seem to have the foggiest idea of what a nuclear bomb actually does. The history of nuclear war is certainly not something which he understands. So the dangers of the use of a nuclear bomb under those circumstances is exceedingly much larger. And I'm not specifically talking about Donald Trump. I'm talking about a major shift in nuclear doctrine which occurred in 2001. And in 2001, there was what is called a nuclear posture review. They put forth, first of all, the notion of preemptive first strike nuclear attack. Now, the preemptive first strike nuclear attack is based on the notion of self-defense. You go in, you knock out the country so that the country doesn't knock you out. Now, whether that country is actually even a nuclear weapon state is not an issue, because a whole large number of countries in the Middle East are targets for nuclear attacks. They're on the drawing board of the Pentagon. But there was another important novelty in that 2001 nuclear posture review is the what is called the mini nuke, or the tactical nuclear weapon, and its recategorization as a conventional weapon. Let me explain. A Hiroshima bomb with a certain explosive capacity led to 100,000 deaths in 7 seconds in 1945 on the 6th of August. The tactical nuclear weapon has an explosive capacity, mini nuke, between 1/3 and 12 times a Hiroshima bomb. So we're not dealing with something which is trivial. The strategic nuclear weapons within both the Russian and American arsenals can go from 100 to even 1,000 times a Hiroshima bomb. So we're dealing with a system of weapons which is capable of blowing up the planet several times. I'm not saying it's going to occur, but the issue which is contemplated is the role that these so-called mini-nukes might play within the conventional war theater. They were categorized in 2001 as, quote, and that's scientific opinion on contract to the Pentagon, quote, harmless to the surrounding civilian population because the explosion is underground, unquote. Now, they subsequently were approved by the US Senate, I believe it was in 2002. They were the object of critique by Senator Edward Kennedy and Senator Feinstein to the effect that this new nuclear doctrine was blurring the line between conventional weapons on the one hand and nuclear weapons on the other, so that a certain category of nuclear weapons now is safe for civilians, it can be used in the conventional war theater, and it's like changing the label on a pack of cigarettes, okay? Smoking is good for your health. This bomb is a peacemaking bomb because it explodes underground and nobody gets hurt. And that goes into the military manuals. That's the labels on the bombs have been changed. Now, I'm bringing this forth for two reasons. One, because we have what the Americans call a situation, okay, with Donald Trump. But that situation has evolved over a long period of time. Last week, the announcement was made of the Nuclear Posture Review 2017, which was Trump's nuclear. I haven't read the whole thing, but the summaries that are given in the news point to what I would describe as déjà vu. It says they are presenting us with a program of smaller, more usable, more friendly nuclear weapons. It's something which was defined back in 2001. There's absolutely nothing new in that regard. What they're trying to do is to give a human face to nuclear destruction. Most probably they've picked up the concepts that have already been elaborated and they've concocted a new nuclear posture review. I don't have the details on that. We published a couple of summaries late last week and I was packing my bags to come to Winnipeg at the time. But what I want to point out to is that when you say that nuclear weapons are harmless to the surrounding civilian population, that's the type of propaganda which is not necessarily intended for the broader public alone. It's intended for decision makers, for people who make decisions within the high ranks of the military and the government, okay? And of course, what the three-star general in, let's say, US Central Command in the Middle East will say, he look at the manual, safe for the surrounding civilian population. Yeah, let's go ahead and use it. And he doesn't need the authorization of Donald Trump, God forbid. And he can choose, that's another concept, any weapon he wants out of the toolbox, so that these nuclear weapons are there in the toolbox. Kalashnikov, cruise missiles, bunker buster bombs with nuclear warheads, B-61-11, B-61-12, etc. That is the context, and miscalculation and misconduct, that's another word, miscalculation, political misconduct, mistakes, and manipulation could lead us to the unthinkable, a third world war with the use of nuclear weapons. The use of those tactical nuclear weapons will lead immediately to escalation. I've no doubt about that. And it is therefore absolutely essential that that we in Canada and around the world, we establish the confines of a new anti-war movement. Most of the people in the anti-war movement that I know, they're good people. First of all, they don't understand many of these things, but they don't want to understand. In the same way, they don't want to understand that the global war on terrorism is fake, that Al-Qaeda is an instrument of the United States, that ISIS was created by the CIA. All this is known and documented. And it's the irony is that in the nuclear doctrine, you say, well, we must be careful that terrorists don't get hold of nuclear weapons, and we therefore must disarm. There's a whole rhetoric. Obama was very good at that. Now, all that is a pack of lies. And we're also in a situation, and then I'm diverting a little bit, but we're in a situation where there's a war against the truth. That sounds a bit like a slogan, but in fact, what it means is that you create realities which are fake, and then you present them as truth. So when the lie becomes the truth, there's no moving backwards. And the mainstream media is an instrument of war propaganda. Back in 2001, 2002, Donald Rumsfeld actually established the Center for Strategic Influence, it was named in that way, which operated out of the Pentagon. And then people complained, including the media, and they said, no, we can't have a Center for Strategic Influence, which consists in influencing the news chain out of the Pentagon. At that time, it was not so much it wasn't the independent media, it was the mainstream media, which was the target. The independent media developed subsequently in a more significant way. But that, I'm sorry, it's the Office of Strategic Influence, OSI, okay? And that, then he made a speech and said, well, I'll abolish the Office of Strategic Influence, but please be assured that all its functions will remain within the offices of the Pentagon. They change the name, they put somebody else in charge, but essentially they are involved in influencing or controlling independent thought, independent media, and so on, to the extent that the public has to be led to believe in a new consensus, not mutually assured destruction as during the Cold War. And we all had that understanding. People who lived through the Cold War knew that nuclear weapons was the weapon of last resort, and it was not something that governments should seek to use. That has been replaced. The mad ideology has been replaced by the madness and insanity, okay? It's another concept. It's not quite the same concept. And the concept is we should go after rogue states or shitholes or whatever. I mean, this type of categorization leads us to say, well, it's probably a humanitarian endeavor to go after, you know, these countries like Libya or Syria, because they're not really countries, we might as well destroy them, okay? That logic has existed for a very, very long time. Because what we've got here is, in fact, the logic to destroy countries. Now, I'm left-handed, and this is very discriminatory because I can't move the mouse button. No, it's okay. I'll use my right hand. This is Pyongyang in 1953. This is Pyongyang today. Now, you won't see these pictures because these pictures go against the notion that Pyongyang could possibly be a modern society with a skyline and public services and so on. And in fact, you have a situation where, in fact, they have very, very high literacy rates. They have an outstanding healthcare sector. In many regards, their social indicators are much higher than those of the United States of America, particularly with regard to literacy. They have a 99%. Now, we're not here to build an apology for North Korea. We just want to say these are people who rebuilt. They started with this. And they're certainly not, they're certainly going to fight to protect what they've got. And if they chose the route of deterrence, that was their own decision. I personally am not very hot on the idea, but it was viewed as, it came rather late, actually. In 2006, they actually offered to rescind their nuclear weapons program in exchange for a peace agreement, and that didn't go through. Now, let me return to the history of nuclear war. 1950, the United States threatened both North Korea and China, and that was prior to the Korean War, with a nuclear attack. Ironically, the threat against China was barely within months after the inauguration of the People's Republic of China in October 1949. Flashback to 1939, the United States initiates the Manhattan Project, which is a project to develop nuclear weapons capabilities, justifying this endeavor as based on the fact that they had to counter Nazi Germany. But in 1939, the United States was not at war with Nazi Germany. In fact, they were collaborating with Nazi Germany. As we know, the Bush family was one of the prominent families involved in cooperation in financial, banking, and even weapons industries. That's another topic. The Manhattan Project was established in 1939. Now, in 1942, at the height of World War II, when both the Soviet Union and the United States of America were allies, the United States was planning a nuclear weapons attack against the Soviet Union. And in 1945, barely 1 month after Hiroshima, August 6, 1945, they released a secret document which has since then been declassified. I think it was declassified about 2 years ago. This document was the object of quite a significant series of initiatives. to bomb 66 Soviet cities with an average of, they had worked out the number of bombs that they needed, and they said about 204 nuclear atomic bombs would be used. Now, what is significant in this, in these documents, is that here you have the list of cities. You can see Moscow 6, Leningrad 6, and so on. The big cities 6, and then the smaller cities. The smaller cities are a bit less. But what was important to understand is that this was formulated during World War II. The official secret document was released on the 15th of September 1945, about a month, 5 weeks after Hiroshima. And it wasn't implemented because they didn't have enough bombs to implement it. But in the meantime, the Russians started to develop their own nuclear weapons capabilities based apparently on intelligence which they had going back to 1942. Now, why do I emphasize this historical dimension? Is first of all because it's diabolical and it precedes the Cold War. It actually was concocted at a time when the two countries were allies. Okay? And that, of course, that is mythology. That's a nonsensical statement. You're there preparing on the destruction of your ally at an early period, and then you bomb the Japanese. And some analysts have actually pointed to the fact that the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki was also a test case. So it's very diabolical. 100,000 people killed in 7 seconds. You can imagine what 66 cities attacked with 204 nuclear weapons. That means the total annihilation of a country, not to mention radiation, which is worldwide. Here you have the document memorandum, 15 September 1945. The attached study has been directed toward establishing an official Army Air Force's view on the number of atomic bombs which should be available to order ensure national security against an ally. Now, admittedly, then officially, the Cold War started in 1947, and I can understand that the Russians were not prepared to have friendly relations with a country which wanted to blow them up, and they developed their own nuclear bomb in 1949. Now, why is this important? Because the whole history of nuclear weapons is based on a Cold War perspective, where you say it was the Cold War, and then they did this, and then we did that. No. The origins of this date back to 1939, the Manhattan Project, and to a plan to blow up the Soviet Union, which was formulated as of 1942. And subsequently, the arms race then led to other countries becoming nuclear weapon states. Britain, no doubt, became a nuclear weapon state because it was initially involved in the Manhattan Project. It was a partner in the Manhattan Project. Canada was a partner. We supplied the uranium. And we also shared on the scientific secrets and so on, that de facto, we were a de facto nuclear weapons state because we were heavily involved in the production and of these nuclear weapons which were used on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Now, let's move on a little bit. Oh, I should mention another thing before, because I've got it on, it's here. Well, the whole series, if you want to go on your handheld, you can actually, all this is available at Global Research, and the document is available also on the announcement of this venue. There was another set of targets, or another scenario. This was formulated in the 1950s, and it's a 56 plan. Now, in this particular case, we are dealing with 1,200 cities targeted for nuclear attack in the Soviet Union, China, and all the so-called satellite countries of Eastern Europe, okay, including, of course, Eastern Germany, Czechoslovakia, and so on. 1,200 cities. Now, the logic of this one is different to the other one, because that one, they might say, well, that one was in response to the fact that the Soviet Union also targets us, and they're absolutely right in that regard. But the initiative of the arms race, or what triggered the arms race, was the decision of the United States, while they were allies with the Soviet Union, to build a nuclear weapons program, which was to target the 66 cities of the USSR with 204 nuclear weapons. It's all very, very, how would I say, diabolical. Now, while I'm at it, because we're talking about global warfare, and I should emphasize, it's very important, North Korea is a buffer state. The ultimate targets are Russia and China. And there are other reasons, economic and political reasons, which they seek to maintain their hegemony in Northeast Asia, to prevent the reunification of the two Koreas, and to prevent that these countries ultimately might become partners with the Chinese and the Russians, okay? So that this is a much more recent document, which dates back, I think, to 2015. You can consult it. It's a public document, and it says war with China. And it is a blueprint commissioned by the U.S. Army to actually blow up China. But they say, well, China is going to resist, and then we have to come in, and then so on and so forth. But ultimately, we will win. And this is a scenario which takes place in the future. Admittedly, this type of stuff is meant to be read by the Chinese, okay? You don't bring out a document and stick it on the internet. It's not a secret document by any means. So it has there's an element of threat behind it. There are all sorts of insinuations, and you can read it. Although a war would harm both economies, damage to China's would be far worse. Because much of the Western Pacific would become a war zone, China's trade with the region and the rest of the world would decline substantially. China's loss of seaborne energy supplies would be especially, that is what they seek. Because China is an upcoming economic power. They're not imposing themselves militarily in the countries with the countries they trade, but they are a threat to U.S. hegemony. The Belt and Road Initiative is a massive project of integration across Eurasia, both by land and by sea. The maritime routes are militarized. We know that. The United States is in Afghanistan for the simple reason that the Chinese are also there, and they have contracts in the copper mining, but they're also building a road from Afghanistan through this strategic corridor right into the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region and on to the province of Gansu, etc. They're integrating the transport routes so that, in fact, that whole region of Central Asia would be trading with China, Pakistan, and so on. I'm diverting a bit from the context, but you can see that this is the scenario of a war with China. The previous ones I gave were war with the Soviet Union, Cold War era, and World War II, the first one formulated in World War II. Now let me return to the issue of the nuclear issue with regard to Korea. In this debate, intimating that North Korea is a threat, a nuclear threat, nobody has taken the trouble to acknowledge, first of all, that South Korea, for a period of almost 10 years, was a nuclear weapons state with the support of the United States, but from a juridical point of view, it was a separate entity. It was established in the 70s. The US nukes were stationed, nuclear facilities were stationed in South Korea starting in 1956, okay? And then they moved them because the delivery systems didn't require them to be right on the doorstep of the DPRK. So that South Korea is a nuclear weapons state and nobody talks about it. But there are a number of other nuclear weapons states that people never talk about them. Belgium, Holland, Turkey, Italy, Germany. There's absolutely no... Turkey has 5 times more bombs than North Korea. And... well, here it is. Belgium, Kleine Brochel. Their base, they have 20 B-61-11s. That's double the number of... Of course, these are the tactical nuclear weapons, harmless to civilians, but they're still nuclear bombs. They're under national command. They're made in America. But that still makes it a nuclear weapon state, irrespective of where the bombs are made. Turkey, who is a sort of rogue NATO member state. I say rogue because they're now building alliances with Russia and Iran against their partners in NATO. But Turkey has 50 of these bombs, and nobody seems to be concerned about that. They're targeted at different places in the Middle East. Germany has 20. Now, I should say something about Germany. Germany is a nuclear weapons state in the fact because Germany has these bombs deployed under national command, not under NATO command, under national command, made in America, but... So that qualifies Germany as a nuclear weapon state, but at the same time, Germany produces nuclear warheads for the French Navy under a joint venture agreement, which initially was Deutsche Aerospace with Aerospatiale Matra, which then became the ARDES conglomerate. Now, it's joint venture. The French Navy has these nuclear weapons. They deploy them. They're a bona fide nuclear weapons state, but they share the technology with Germany. So that Germany is also a nuclear weapons state. Nobody seems to be concerned about that. Israel is a nuclear weapons state and is recognized, and there we are. Now, in the course... Now, let me mention one other issue, which is crucial. because we see how double standards are in the process of inserting themselves into these realities, but coverage by the media is never there. They won't say that DPRK is the victim of extensive war crimes. They want to defend themselves, they want to whatever. Okay, they're socialists or communists, but that's not the issue. That's their right to be whatever they want to be. And even if their head of state is a crazy guy with a funny haircut, that is not an issue as far as sovereignty is concerned. That's their concern, not ours. Now, and we don't need to knock off his head with a nuclear bomb. And I'm not joking, because actually during preceding the war in Iraq, they said that they would use bunker buster nuclear bombs to kill Saddam Hussein in his bunker. Okay? They said it's a precision bomb, we could actually do that. That's a Pentagon document. Now, before we proceed, let's return to the Vancouver Group. The Vancouver Group regroups, first of all, many of the nuclear weapons states. They haven't listed the countries. I tried to get the tally, but the nuclear weapons states are all there. China, Russia, and the DPRK are not invited, as we mentioned earlier. And these countries meeting in Vancouver are demanding and pressuring North Korea to abolish its nuclear weapons program. That is the purpose, and threatening them, if they don't, we will bomb you preemptively. Now, for those who have followed the campaign of the international campaign to abolish nuclear weapons, which resulted in a United Nations General Assembly resolution back in 2016, and which has recently resulted in a formal agreement, as well as the Nobel Prize granted to the ICAD. Some of you might, of course, have seen it. It was broadcast on television. The Western media didn't give too much coverage. But one important question is the following. The vote, nobody knows about this because it didn't come out in the newspapers, unless you go into the archives of the General Assembly. The vote against the motion was 38, which included, according to Canadian mainstream media, all the nuclear weapons states. It was adopted by more than 120 in favor and 38 against. I think that's my recollection. And then they said all the nuclear weapons states are against the abolition of nuclear weapons. It's a lie. North Korea voted in favor of the abolition of nuclear weapons. And it is the only nuclear weapons state that actually did that. China abstained. India abstained, Pakistan abstained. Russia voted against, okay? So that what you have is the Western Bloc nuclear weapon states, Britain, France, United States, Israel, plus Russia, and then the other ones either abstained and one voted against. That pointed to the fact that a decision was taken by the North Korean government that they were in favor of the resolution and they would endorse a process. Of course, they're not prepared to give up their the nuclear weapons without there being a process of abolition worldwide, including the major nuclear weapons countries, which include, of course, Russia, China, and the United States, and among others. But I think it's significant, at least, that we acknowledge the fact that this small country in Northeast Asia actually voted in favor of the abolition of nuclear weapons, and it was the only one of the nuclear weapons states. And and I now want to turn my attention to the peace procedures, or whatever, the peace solutions which are being envisaged. I've had the opportunity of traveling back and forth to South Korea several times. I'm going to be in South Korea later in February, and I also presented some of these ideas to both in the Korean Parliament and to other audiences. But what I think is very important to understand is that at this juncture, South Korea is a de facto proxy colony of the United States, up at least with regard to military affairs. Let me explain. Because there was no peace agreement, there is a persistent state of war from a legal point of view. And there is a concept which is called Operation Control. Operation Control means that the United States controls not only its own forces within Korea, which are of the order of 27 to 28,000, they're stationed in South Korea. They also, through a joint defense agreement, they also control the totality of the South Korean armed forces, both personnel and equipment. It's called the Combined Forces Command. So Operation Control was the concept which developed in the wake of the Korean War under a pseudo United Nations mandate, and now they call it the Combined Forces Command. Now, the Combined Forces Command means that United States could actually call a war on China or Russia and mobilize Korean forces, South Korean forces. And since they're persistently in a state of war, the Korean president, who is also identified as commander-in-chief, is virtually not a commander-in-chief, because they say in a state of war, it's the US general appointed by the Pentagon who takes over. And now that agreement was renewed by the previous president, Mrs. Park, who's the daughter of dictator Park, who was assassinated in 1979. I actually went to, my first trip to South Korea was in 1980, just a few months after he was assassinated. But that's another story. So during her mandate, they renewed this agreement, and they renewed also the whole process of militarization of South Korea. They're building military bases and so on. What is required, and I think the dynamics is already ongoing, but this is something that's been discussed for several years, is that the armistice agreement would be in a sense nullified with the signing of a North-South agreement between North and South Korea, a peace agreement, without going through the process of the three member states, which are signatories of the armistice, because they're blocked by the United States. And then that peace agreement between North and South would in fact nullify the armistice, and it would have to be coupled with a repeal of the Joint Defense Forces Agreement, or the Operation Command, which would then more or less detach the Korean armed forces from the clutch of the Pentagon, which calls the shots in the case of war. That's not going to be an easy process, but it should also be understood that this Korean crisis is also a struggle for U.S. hegemony in East Asia. And let me get to the map just to give you an idea. The distance is, first of all, let me say a few things about distance, because it's very important. Trump hasn't the foggiest idea of distance. Well, he knows that the distance between the Trump Tower in New York and his casino in Atlantic City, okay? It's something of the order 100 kilometers. But for Trump's information, Seoul is 53 kilometers from the border with North Korea. And it's about, I would say, 150 to Pyongyang. And the North Korean border is about 100 kilometers from Vladivostok, if you can read it in Cyrillic. That's Russia's Asian, Far East Asian regional pole. And North Korea has borders with the provinces of Liaoning and Jilin, which of course is also very important for trade and so on. Now, a couple of months ago, the Russian president made a proposal to have a trading agreement which would link Russia, China, North Korea and South Korea with road networks which would come from South Korea into North Korea and then would go towards Vladivostok, and of course some of those roads are already there, but it would be based on some kind of Northeast Asian trade agreement, a bit, you know, a sort of a NAFTA in the Asian context. And of course that kind of initiative immediately impinges on U.S. hegemony. Japan would most probably be partner in that kind of endeavor. So that any kind of reunification of North and South is a slap in the face to the United States, because it then has to deal with a country, first of all, which has far greater sovereignty, which has a population going on to 80 million people, 50 to 55 million in South Korea, plus 25 million in North Korea, combining tremendous scientific, technological, military capabilities. A reunited Korea would become a major rival in, it already is, South Korea already a rival in many areas of the global economy. But the hegemonic project is always to keep these countries separate and to fragment them. That's it's the same process in the Middle East. You carve countries up like you're doing in Iraq and Syria. So that's the other dimension of this process, is the process of unification of the region. But we are facing tremendous obstacles because the whole model of hegemony as far as the United States is concerned, is the regional command structures. So it's Pacific Command, it's the Pacific Command, it's Central Command in the Middle East, it's Northern Command as far as United States and, well, Canada as well, although not officially, we're not members, but all the military command structures in all major regions of the world are the basis upon which U.S. economic hegemony is established. And this kind of restructuring of the Northeast Asian region with reunification would indeed lead to competing or reinforcing the trading bloc which the Chinese are in the process of building, which is the Belt and Road Initiative, but they're also allied with Russia. They also have good trading relations with South Korea. So that is the background of this Korean crisis and the dangers of nuclear war. I should mention to conclude that I don't think that there is going to be any kind of major upheaval in the Korean Peninsula in the short run. There's a much greater likelihood for escalation in the Middle East. The Middle East is fragile, and of course, well, the Russians are also involved in the Middle East, but there's more of a likelihood of escalation in the Middle East. The US had the doctrine of, which is announced in the Project of the New American Century, of waging simultaneous rather than consecutive theater wars. It's very clearly enunciated. We will wage simultaneous theater wars. They don't say why, but they are not, I don't think that they are in a position to carry out those simultaneous operations. They're much more in a consecutive mode at the moment. But I think it's very important that all these things are understood. They're very complex. And the instrument, the most powerful of instrument of peacemaking is ultimately, at this stage, is counter-propaganda. It's to build a consensus which will counter the legitimacy of the war criminals in high office. It's something which can only be achieved if we harness large numbers of people across the land, nationally and internationally, but that process has to be based on an understanding which is not being provided by the mainstream media. And at the same time, the independent media is the target, okay? The independent media is now being the target. I won't go into that. We've been targeted as well. We're not the only ones. And it's absolutely essential that we build mass organizations, but we can't build mass organizations which are funded by corporate foundations. A lot of them are, and I'm not blaming them for that. I'm just saying it doesn't work. There's a lot of corporate money that goes to fund various organizations, NGOs, activists, very often on a piecemeal basis, keeping all the issues separate. That's the logic of the World Social Forum, which from the outset was funded by the Ford Foundation. And everybody knows that. And the Ford Foundation is linked to the CIA. So again, a real people's movement against war and neoliberalism has to be structured in a way which does not accept the funding from the people who are the targets of the protest movement, okay? So you can't ask Wall Street to pay for your travel expenses and then expect to then wage a protest movement against Wall Street. And I'm not exaggerating, Wall Street does finance many of these large venues. We're open to Q&A. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yes, I have a question. I'm not quite sure what to make of what you finally said tonight, just because watching all this going on with the threatening of North Korea seems to be more or less a pantomime in order to prevent the kind of unity of the on the Korean Peninsula and the greater economic unity in the area, which leads me to believe that you don't seem to think that all of the threats back and forth are really that significant, or we should be too concerned about it. Well, I'm not sure that's what you said, but the other thing is, it would seem to me that the response of Korea, North Korea, the Democratic Republic of Korea, their only real rational route right now is to do exactly as they're doing. The only deterrent to the kind of military threats or other military threats that the U.S. is making would be exactly that, to develop their own capability of at least inflicting some harm on the United States. They can't use them. They're not an aggressive nation. And so is that what you would think in terms of the going forward position of the Democratic Republic now? Or is it something else? Or is it you think that this is largely something that's being played out on a large scale that really doesn't mean very much when it comes right down to it in terms of the threat of the
Well, I agree with you. It is being played out on a grand scale. The North Korean leader is not helping that because he is also using strong rhetoric. But I think we have to understand that country has been threatened with nuclear war for 67 years, and that every year they have war games right at the border. You can look at the map. They are being threatened militarily. Now, whatever the North Korean says, well, we can do it as well, or we have a button as well. Of course, it is magnified by the media, and then this country, which lost 30% of its people in the Korean War, is presented as a major threat to the security of Americans, and of course, the media is going to magnify those statements. But that's what deterrence is all about. They're playing the game of mutually assured destruction. I think it's unfortunate that the North Korean rhetoric has taken on that form, because they could have said the same thing in a less sort of aggressive way. But on the other hand, they're a country which has been subjected to threats for almost since they declared their independence from the Japanese, okay? It's 1945. And of course, that was the moment when the US came and intervened. So I think that the United States has to live with the fact that there's one more nuclear weapons state in the world, which is North Korea. And as I mentioned, there are others. There's Turkey. What are they going to do with Turkey? They also have nuclear weapons. But they can certainly, and then if they want to build, they can build a peace process. And I think that, and then the next stage would be the abolition of nuclear weapons. The North Koreans say they're in favor. They are the only country which has officially acknowledged of the nuclear weapon states that they would dismantle their arsenal if there is a peaceful solution. But I don't think they would ever get that guarantee. I think the threat will continue as long as North Korea is not complying.
Thank you for your talk tonight.
And thank you.
A couple questions. You can take one or both. You portray Donald Trump, of course, as the buffoon we all know him to be, but George Bush W. was no different. And there are more conscious forces clearly at play in the U.S. government that are quite happy to have the president play the clown while they do the real business. So I just want you to talk about which forces politically. Is it still the neocon movement, you know, that was the analysis 10 years ago, or is it something just off the rails, in your opinion, bordering on madness? Number two, you speak of a global movement for a real peace movement, or a re-beginning. What I see happening, you know, Slavoj Žižek, the philosopher, talks about capitalism with Asian values, meaning authoritarian capitalism, where once capitalism spread, neoliberalism, and a sort of liberal society throughout Europe and North America. That seems to be the doors to open thought, despite the internet, and action and collective organization seem to be closing globally, not opening towards that kind of movement. So what do you propose as a sort of methodology for creating that global movement where citizens actually have real power against these massive, massive structures and agendas? Thanks.
Well, first of all, it's a long and complex question, but let me start with the latter part of your questions. There's no doubt in my mind that China, as well as Russia, are oppressive capitalist societies. But I would say China is probably the most oppressive. And that's important in whatever mass movement we enter into. But given the geopolitical context, China is not a threat to global security at this juncture. But when I say that China is an advanced capitalist economy, first of all, I've been studying the Chinese economy. I started studying the Chinese economy in the 1980s, and I brought out a book which was called Towards the Restoration of Capitalism, and then people on the left said, you're absolutely nuts. What are you talking about? We're not going to publish this. Nonsense. It goes against the laws of history. All the socialists, particularly in Latin America, well, I published it with Palgrave Macmillan, which is an establishment publishing company. But I think that 30 years later, it's pretty obvious what China has become. I did field work in rural areas in the 1980s. I went back to some of those areas. I asked the guy, there was a people's commune. There were 1,000 families. And then I said, what happened to the People's Commune? And he said, the People's Commune is now a holding company. And who are the owners of the holding company? And he said, him, me, and him. Okay? The three people who received me at the township. Well, that's an anecdote, but the process is capitalism. There's no question about it. Some people think that China is still a socialist country, but I mean, it hasn't been a socialist country for quite a while. Okay. I want to bring it out again in an e-book with a preface. There's one dimension. 275 million migrant workers in China, internally, official figures. That's colossal workforce, which integrates the Belt and Road infrastructure projects, the buildings, the urbanization, the service, well, not so much the service economy, certainly cheap labor, made in China manufacturing. So that is capitalism, and it's also integrated into global capitalism. So yes, a movement goes in steps. It doesn't necessarily need, and we're not going to build a paradigm or say we want this paradigm. We have to look at the realities of the global economy to understand what kind of social actions are required. And build alliances and have broad-based organizations. Now, with regard to the neocons, the neocons, it's hard to define them because it's not always clear who they are, but you have the intelligence apparatus, you have the Pentagon, you have the think tanks, the Council on Foreign Relations, the Bank of International Settlements, Wall Street, the Federal Reserve, and so on. That's the neoconservative apparatus. And Trump didn't quite fit into that apparatus. But he's now conforming. And it's a hegemonic project. And it was predicated, particularly during the Obama administration, on narrowing the relations with Russia and also confronting China. Now that started, that I think had a lot to do with certain internal changes both within China and Russia. In China, it was the end of the Deng Xiaoping era. Deng Xiaoping was a US puppet. Not totally, but he was very much, very pro-American. There's still a very pro-American elite in China. There are various contradictions and cross-cutting alliances. But nonetheless, to get back to the issue of the neocons, during the election campaign, the fundamental issue on which they diverged was on relations with Russia. Okay? And then it took the shape of this Russia phobia scenario of smearing Russia, describing Trump as an agent, a Moscow agent, as a Manchurian candidate, and so on and so forth, which was absurd, and describing any media actually who would support who is opposed to the Russiaphobia as agents of Moscow. We've also been accused of agents of Moscow, okay? But I happen to be on the blacklist of Russia Today as well, so that's not a bad thing these days. I think in the United States that the big problem is that you have a left which is associated with the Democratic Party, and which in effect is complicit in accepting US foreign policy. They accept it. And I'm talking about entities like Democracy Now and so on. It's they accept that the Democratic Party is an elite party, but at the same time it has a left wing. And they are also part of the protest movements, but those protest movements are co-opted in large part.
Yeah, my question for you is, you had mentioned earlier the need for a new or renewed anti-war movement in Canada, and I was wondering if you could give some examples of maybe some like specific demands that a renewed anti-war movement would or could have in terms of different levels of government, etc.
Well, I think an anti-war movement has to be consistent in its in the positions that it takes in relation to ongoing wars. Now, there's an ongoing war in Yemen, there's an ongoing war in Syria, there's an ongoing war in Palestine and other places, and then there are various forms of intervention in Central America, in Venezuela. And it's not a, if you have people within that anti-war movement who state explicitly that Bashar al-Assad is killing his own people, we can't build an anti-war movement with people like that, okay? Because first of all, it's a lie. And secondly, it denies the fact that those who are fighting against government forces are mercenaries paid by the CIA, by the Pentagon, by Saudi Arabia. They are, well, they may be jihadists, but essentially they're mercenaries. They're people who are hired, recruited, and then sent to the front and financed, generously financed, and it's so well documented. So people who say that we should, you know, we should support the White Helmets, or we should support the rebels who are protesting against their government, that kind of anti-war movement is redundant. In fact, it becomes an apology. And I quoted, I know that we can't, you know, critique Noam Chomsky, but Noam Chomsky is supporter of U.S. foreign policy. He's made a statement in favor of regime change in Syria, okay? But he made the statement in other contexts as well. So that we don't want to have a mass movement is a mass movement without left-wing icons which are supported by the establishment. Now, why is he an icon? Because he writes in the New York Times, he's heralded by the media as a left-wing, prominent, reliable left-wing. I mean, we're dealing with governments which are involved in criminal undertakings. War is criminal. I if you go back to Nuremberg, I was involved in Kuala Lumpur with I was member of the War Crimes Commission. The Kuala Lumpur War Crimes Commission. We had several procedures against the State of Israel, one against the Bush et al. And the whole concept was the criminalization of war. Now, we must, if we're going to go ahead with an anti-war movement, we don't want people saying, well, you know, there are some cases when we should intervene militarily to protect the rights of women. Okay? Angelina Jolie is inciting NATO to come to protect the women against the men, presumably. I mean, this is the kind of absurdity. We don't want people like that in an anti-war movement. And there's certain principles of international law that we have to follow. War is illegal. It is the ultimate supreme crime against humanity. And the only justification for war is self-defense. And of course, they'll play around with that concept. That's why they invaded Afghanistan. They said, we were attacked by Afghanistan on September 11, 2001. Now, I didn't see any Afghan planes in the skies of New York. Okay.
You don't mind, I'm gonna stand here.
Yeah, I hear you.
If the positive peace or peace literacy movement combined, the same thing as the anti-war movement. Peace literacy is a defined term by a retired captain from the U.S. military who served in Iraq named Paul K. Chappell, C-H-A-P-P-E-L-L. His latest book in a series of six so far is called Soldiers of Peace. And his contribution to a better world is really to create an army of peace builders of the kind Gandhi recommends. Are you able to comment on whether you can put a positive aspect on this and do grassroots peace building starting right here in Winnipeg or in Ottawa, where you're from, and do in Canada what we're suggesting the whole world should do, and make all the sacrifices necessary, perhaps like stopping taking uranium from the ground, perhaps ending nuclear energy, starting with those kinds of things right here, and then changing the world order through our own country at the United Nations, and go back to the original aspirations for the United Nations and for UNESCO. Those are my comments. I'd like your reaction.
Well, I'm not familiar with the concept you, or with the book that you mentioned. I think certainly there's a case to be made for procedures to protect the peace and to defend the nation, okay? That may be a military concept, but you cannot interfere in other countries militarily on the grounds that they are violating certain rules and so on and so forth. In other words, the whole concept of humanitarian wars, which has been put forth, and the notion of so-called responsibility to protect, R2P, that kind of discourse has to be scrapped. Now, clearly, anti-war movement is ultimately geared towards establishing peace on planet Earth, but it would also signify disarming the entire military-industrial establishment, closing down the military bases, getting rid of certain types of weapons. That's not going to happen overnight. The initiative to abolish nuclear weapons would be a first step. But you have a whole series of other weapon systems. Any kind of movement that unfolds has to address the current state of war which exists today. We're not going to build some kind of a utopia overnight. We want to reverse the tide of war. And you don't reverse the tide of war, at least that's my opinion, through petitions to the people who are waging war. You question their legitimacy. If the people in high office, including Trump, including our own prime minister, are supportive of military undertakings, let's say in Yemen, or the sale of weapons to countries waging war, well, we question their legitimacy because they have violated international law in so doing. And we don't send them a petition and say, "Dear President Obama, dear President Trump, stop killing people. We'd like, and we've got 20,000 signatures." That's not the way to do it. We have to build a counter discourse and we have to confront the people in high office. Yeah.
My question is, you want to confront people in high office, but how much power do the people in high office really hold when you have, like, the Continuity of Government Act, where there's a shadow government that's still in place since 9/11, doing God knows what, or you see the effects of what they do? How do you protest somebody who you don't vote for and who are just behind the scenes and actually making the policy? And, you know, it's so discouraging to see people focused on the clown that's in office now, or thinking that Obama was somehow a good guy in what he was doing. How can you be effective in protesting that if you're focused? It's like sort of the Wizard of Oz behind the curtain. You're just focused on, you know, something that's not really going to make a difference.
You're absolutely right. I mean, We in our understanding, we have to establish the relationship between the politicians in high office and the ultimate decision makers, which reside in the weapons industry, the oil companies, Wall Street, the Washington's think tanks, the mercenary companies. I mean, there's a whole panoply of private institutions, the Federal Reserve. You're right in the sense that you can target Trump and say, well, Trump must be impeached, but immediately they're going to put somebody else who will be a similar type of proxy, so that any form of any kind of meaningful movement will have to assess those relationships. It's all encompassing. It's not a simplified process of going against governments. It's reforming, broadly reforming an economic and social apparatus. And that's why I say that there's been very little debate between the resistance to neoliberalism on the one hand and the anti-war movement. And why? Because the people who fund will not allow for a more integrated debate. I'm talking about the World Social Forum. If you've been to the World Social Forum, what you have is a whole series of do-it-yourself, of piecemeal issues, environment, women's issues, indigenous rights, and hardly ever anything on war, and very little overlap, okay? And it then you may have people who are saying exactly different things. It's not on the basis of the World Social Forum that you're going to build an integrated movement against war and globalization. But the moment you start mixing or looking at the links, your corporate funders will cut you off. Of course, look at a guy like Brzezinski. The case of McNamara. He goes from the state, from the Pentagon, to the World Bank. Okay. That kind of interface is quite frequent. There's a lot of interface between the financial institutions on the one hand and the defense apparatus. And I think that we have to start looking at that. It might be much more a question of dismantling institutions like NATO, which would be broadly the base for an anti-war movement. When you start dismantling a military apparatus in one form or another, rather than going after the legitimacy, as you mentioned, of politicians in high office. But it's a very complicated process, and it's only if people are well informed that they'll be able to come to grips with those, with that kind of relationship between macroeconomic agents, people in the military, people in intelligence, and so on. And academics and researchers and scientists.
I think we may have time for one more question. If anyone has one, I can bring the mic up to you. Okay.
This is a very simple question, because what we might look at is what is the role of the United Nations. We have some assumptions that ideally they can intervene into conflicts to stop it from either escalating or even stop it from starting. But there seems to be no good evidence of that. We've seen one-sided evidence that they will support more oppressive mechanisms than liberatory mechanisms. I have seen, and I think others have noticed too, that there are self-inflicted wounds, that countries inflict wounds on themselves for the purposes of legitimizing they're going into or going against other countries in war mechanisms. How do we organize to stop that? Or what is the role of the United Nations in that?
Yeah, well, the United Nations is an instrument of U.S. foreign policy, or has become an instrument of U.S. foreign policy, although it was very much an instrument right from the outset. The United Nations Security Council is being used to justify military interventions which ultimately are in violation of the United Nations Constitution. It doesn't mean because the United Nations Security Council said it's okay to invade Iraq or whatever. Well, they didn't say that, but it doesn't give any legality. And the UN is, in many regards, an instrument. We have the impression that countries exercise their vote, but very often their vote is purchased, is bought up. And in the Security Council, the non-veto members of the Security Council are very often co-opted. They're paid. You buy them out. You give them $1 million, and they'll do it. And that happens when a situation where manipulation prevails, internal propaganda. It's a very corrupt organization. There's some good people in there. That's something we have to tackle. Is how do we confront the UN? But it goes back to your question. But behind the UN, there's U.S. intelligence. I mean, take the case of Feltman, Jerry Feltman. He's the Undersecretary of the United Nations. He's a former CIA. Well, he still is. He's in charge of Middle East. Well, he went to North Korea recently, okay? And then he went to Beijing. But he was also involved in the Middle East, the war in Syria, and so on. And then he was with the State Department, and then he's appointed to the United Nations, okay? So they have their people there right at the top.
Well, you know, I think that Professor Chossudovsky would be open to, you know, chatting a little bit in the hallway or something if anybody wants to talk, and of course there's some books to sign. So I hope you'll all thank you for coming out on this cold January evening, and I think we had a great conversation and some great detailed exposition here. So please join me once again thanking our guest, Michel.
Thank you very much.
And drive home safe.